In this series, I'll show you how to get started with Blender's grease pencil. In this first video, I'll go over setting up and using brushes, materials, layers, and the draw mode tools. By the end of this video, you'll be able to make an animation just like this one, even if you don't have any drawing skills yet. We'll start off with a new file and choose 2D animation. This puts you in this nice setup optimized for working with the grease pencil. I'll also turn on screencast keys here so you can see my keystrokes in the bottom corner. We have a grease pencil object already, sort of a default stroke instead of a default cube. So the first thing you want to pay attention to is your drawing plane. Right now I'm drawing on the XZ plane, and you can see that if I go rotate the view. I can change that to the side or top plane, but the interesting one is view. This lets you draw strokes on a plane parallel to your current view. The tricky thing about using view is that there is no good way to realign your view to those strokes again. I personally prefer drawing in the front plane because I can always rotate my strokes later if I need to. Now let's look at the brush settings. The two main things to pay attention to are the radius and the strength. The radius is the thickness of your strokes and the strength is the opacity, so a 1 is fully opaque and a 0 is fully transparent. You can change the values manually or press F and move your mouse in and out for the radius, and Shift F for the strength. If you have a drawing tablet and want to use pen pressure, you can turn it on here for the radius and strength respectively. By default, you start on the pencil brush, but there's a whole lot of others. They each come with their own default radius and strength settings, so making your pencil really thick won't affect, say, your airbrush radius. Now let's add some color to this. There's a drop down here where I can choose other materials to use. Let's pick that red one. And see, that's definitely red, but it's made up of little squares instead of a continuous line, which I don't love. To change that, we'll go to the material properties. The default stroke comes with these four materials preset for you. An important thing to realize here is that there are material slots and materials assigned to those slots. You can add and remove slots with the plus minus button and reorder them with the up down arrow. Notice how when I removed the first slot with the solid stroke, all of those lines turned into red squares. This is because the object no longer has the first material, and so it picks the next one in line. To assign a material to a slot, you select the slot and then click this menu here, and it pulls up all the grease pencil materials in this file. Notice how the solid stroke is still on the list because it still exists in the Blender file. When we remove the material slot, that is not the same thing as deleting the material. It's just removing it from this object. I could also just make a new material. Each material has either a stroke, fill, or both. You can change the color with the color wheel. You can also use the dropper to copy a color from anywhere on screen. And if you select self-overlap, then a stroke can overlap itself. This is useful if you're doing like pencil shading in one stroke. Note that whether or not you have self-overlap checked, if you cross another stroke, it will overlap. One last thing to be aware of before you start drawing is layers. They're over here right above the material properties. You add, remove, and reorder layers basically the same as with materials, but here the order actually matters because whichever layer is on top covers what's beneath it. You can also toggle the visibility of the layers with the eye icon or lock it so it's uneditable, which is really handy if you have like a rough sketch layer and then an actual line art layer. Control the opacity of each layer as you see fit, and also toggle onion skinning, which is when you see a faint image of the previous and following keyframes. What are keyframes, you ask? Simply put, they're the different frames of animation, the different drawings that you have. If auto keying is enabled down here, which it should be if you started with a 2D animation file, all you have to do to add a new keyframe is to go forward in the timeline and start drawing. If auto keying is turned off, however, you can manually add new keyframes by pressing I and choosing which type of keyframe you want. Back to onion skinning, it's really helpful for ensuring your different frames all flow nicely into one another. You can control the opacity, color, and number of keyframes ahead and before that will display as onion skin. This last toggleable option for layers is masking, which is more complicated. I'll cover that another day. For now, just know that you can enable or disable it here. Now let's get to the draw mode tools. Since you've already seen the basic draw tool pretty extensively, let's talk about the fill tool. This lets you fill in areas really quickly as long as they're closed, and with some of the new Blender 2.93 features, even if they're open. So you're generally going to want a solid material, and the basic use is that you click where you want the color and it fills in that region. Here, however, when I try to fill this, I get this error message along the bottom that says it can't fill an open area. To fix this, go to this advanced dropdown here and turn on stroke extensions. Now when I click, all these blue lines show up, and these are temporarily extended strokes. I can increase or decrease them with the scroll wheel or page up and down. Once the area I care about is closed by the blue lines, I just click again and it fills in the region. If you're using Blender 2.92 or before, you can't close the gaps like this, but what you can do is increase the leak size, which is how large a gap the fill tool will overlook. Back to new Blender features, if your fills aren't quite the right shape, you can increase your precision to get more precise fills. This last feature is especially cool. So let's say you've got a lot of frames you want to fill in with the same color. If you enable multi-frames right here, then select all the keyframes you're interested in from the timeline, you can fill them all at once. And don't worry if the object doesn't overlap on all the frames, just fill in the ones it does overlap on, and then select the next group of keyframes and fill those. Another important thing to note is that the fill tool can't make a filled in area with a hole in the center. So if you're making a face and you fill it in, you'll notice the eyes got filled in there as well. Just keep this in mind and always do your biggest fills first and your smaller ones later. The last hand thing thing to know about the fill tool is you can change the fill direction from normal to inverted. The erase tool has several settings. Dissolve works the most like an actual eraser, slowly reducing the strength of strokes until they reach zero. At this point, it cuts out that section. Of the three settings, dissolve is the only one with a variable strength. Point deletes the points along a stroke wherever you click, and stroke simply deletes the whole stroke. The tint tool lets you add a color over your existing strokes and fill. You can set it to only affect one or the other if you like. You can change the color from this drop down here. This is a great option for adding some quick variation to your work. Next, the cutter tool. This tool removes pieces of strokes mainly based on intersections. I love using this tool because it lets me be lazy when I'm drawing. For example, when I'm drawing an eye, and I want to make sure it's fully closed. I don't want to have to spend too much time making certain it's completely closed, especially if I'm trying to maintain pin pressure on the stroke. So I can just draw past the intersection, then afterwards take the cutter tool and remove the excess. The flat caps option for the cutter is also very handy for keeping these little bits from sticking out. The eyedropper tool lets you easily make new materials by clicking anything in the viewport. I find this helpful if I have a reference image with colors that I want to copy. Lastly, you can add in preset shapes if you want. When you put them in, holding shift will make the shape more symmetric. Now you'll notice I can't use another tool. That's because Blender is still waiting for me to finish this box. I can adjust the yellow nodes as I like, move the whole shape around by pressing G and dragging, and then when I'm happy with it, I hit enter, and it's ready. Now with all that covered, you're ready to start drawing. However, I am not because I'm still bad at actually drawing. So I'm going to go to Mixamo.com. Links are in the description for a pre-animated walk cycle. I am not sponsored or anything. This is just an entirely free resource that I personally find really helpful. So I'm going to search for walking, and there's a whole host of options, but I'll go with this more natural looking walk. There's a lot of variables I can adjust here, like speed, arm spacing, and stride length, but the option I care about right now is this in-place box, which makes the animation walk in place. Now I'll just download this as an FBX, go back to Blender, import the FBX, and adjust it. You can always draw at any angle you want. I am going to draw it from a side view. So let's recap what we learned by adding a new grease pencil object and tracing this. First, set up your material settings. I want the solid black stroke. Note that this was already available because we had the default stroke. Then, I want a white fill for the character and a gray fill for the background. Then, let's set up the layers. I'm going to make a trace, fill, and background layer. Check your brush settings to make sure they're how you want them. I'll go ahead and pin the solid stroke to the pin. Make sure you're drawing on your intended drawing plane and that you're on the right layer. Lastly, I'll move the grease pencil in front of the reference so there's no overlap, and now you can start tracing. If you really want to practice your drawing skills, I would recommend drawing it again, but this time over to the side. I won't be doing that, primarily because I'm lazy. Also notice that I'm not drawing every frame of movement because I'd go crazy doing that. For this animation, I'm doing a keyframe about every 3 frames, but you can do whatever level of detail you want. Now you may notice that I'm not paying too much attention to detail as I go, and that's intentional because I'm just getting the rough outline right now. I'll add more detail and refine it in the next video, which will be all about sculpt mode and how it's your best friend. If you want to see that, then check back soon. My last step is to do the fills. I'll use the inverted fill method and multiframe here to fill all the frames at once. Then I'll turn off multiframe and put the fill direction back to normal and add the background. That's really all there is to it, and remember, if I can do this with no talent, you can do better.